Elements of Alpine Ski Racing. There are some specific basic elements of skiing that, when mastered, will result in outstanding race day performance.
And it starts right here. Fourth in Levy. She has got top slalom speed for sure.
No signs of backing off. Maze building on the lead.
And it's almost like she's running GS. Everything is so stoic on the top part of her body, and it's the bottom part. Skiing the right line and skiing it strong.
Wow. And so often you see in Super Combined, people will know they have a lead to pad and they can work with it. Not Maze. Maze on a tear to the line. This victory is hers, and by nearly a second.
That is a statement.
Good physical conditioning is essential for the athlete who wants to excel. The conditioning program must begin long before the athlete goes on snow, and a maintenance program should be continued throughout the season. The program should be progressive in nature and include training for strength, power, quickness, balance, agility, coordination, as well as development of the athlete's aerobic base and anaerobic capacity. The athlete should always prepare for training or racing with a good warm-up that includes both static and ballistic stretching. I would strongly encourage each athlete, along with his or her coach, develop a warm-up routine that will become part of a pre-training or race ritual. Some free skiing should comprise an essential component of this pre-training or race ritual. Free skiing is an important component in the overall development of ski racing skills. You can't do enough of it. Free skiing will help develop athleticism, balance, quickness, agility, and coordination. It develops adaptability and spontaneity, will improve your proprioceptive awareness, help increase your strength and power, and it's a great aerobic conditioner. Remember, ski all terrain in any conditions. Start slow and build to race speeds. Vary your skiing with a mix of long and short turns in and out of the fall line for the greatest benefits. Get good at skiing flats, steeps, groomed and ungroomed trails, bumps, powder, and ice, and be able to do it in any conditions, snow, wind, rain, and fog. You may want to include some specific drills in your warm-up routine that will help you establish a basis for your performance skiing. You can get creative in your free skiing by doing things like synchronized skiing, which is fun, and actually develop skills relevant to ski racing, like looking ahead, timing, rhythm, and flow. In ski racing, intent dictates technique. Ski technique must serve a spectrum of purposes and intents for the ski racer. Turns serve exclusively the offensive intent to control direction precisely and efficiently, to go exactly where you want to go as fast as possible. An understanding of and the execution of skiing fundamentals will serve as a foundation for your skiing success. In addition, the ski racer must combine speed and finesse with power and efficiency, along with a mental capacity to handle the demands of ski racing in order to be successful. The unifying master principle of alpine ski turns is what I call the principle of positive movements. All skier movements in alpine skiing tend to be in the direction of the new turn. In a right turn, nothing moves left. This rule applies to tipping movements, rotational movements, movements of the body as a whole, or any part of it. Good turns include positive movements exclusively. To start a turn, you tip the skis into the turn, and the body moves to the inside of the new turn. Remember, you ski from the waist down, you balance from the waist up. Maintain a quiet upper body for the best balance and most efficient skiing. The red skier is gliding smoothly here and demonstrating the positive movements of good ski turns, skiing the slow line fast. Right tip right is the mantra of a good turn. The yellow skier is braking, skiing the fast line slow. Left tail right, not to go right, is a better description of the movements as he starts these defensive turns. There are three essentials of a good turn. Edging, where the skis are placed on the new turning edges against the wall or the hill. Pressurization, pressure gradually builds on the new turning skis. And leverage, with good fore-aft and lateral balance on the skis. Increased edging builds towards pressurization. An increased edging and pressurization build towards leverage. This all happens on a continuum with timing, flow, and tempo. Skiing comprises a symphony of movements. Edging, pressure, and leverage all move through a spectrum progressively with timing, rhythm, and flow to maintain balance, create a desired turn shape, and take you where you want to go as fast as possible. These are the touch tones of a good ski turn. Although we sometimes like to separate and identify these different segments of a turn, it's very difficult because each one happens on a continuum. Timing is critical as to when the skis are put on edge, and engagement of the edges works progressively toward the future, allowing pressure to build on the skis. As pressure continually builds, leverage must be increased to resist the combined forces of gravity and centrifugal force that will build on the skier. To provide the needed leverage to manage these forces, the skier moves forward into the inside of the turn. This movement forward into the inside is in combination with a lengthening of the outside leg and a corresponding retraction of the inside leg. The management of edging, pressure, and leverage is constantly changing as a result of the terrain, phase of the turn, turn shape, and snow surface. Edging, pressure, and leverage, when applied with timing, flow, and tempo, these are the fundamental habits we seek to master as good ski racers. These comprise the fundamental mother turn we must learn and teach, and from which all great skiing emanates. Tipping movements are smooth and continuous as skis roll from edge to edge through the transition. Turns begin and end with edge release movements, and each new turn begins well back in the previous turn. Here you see the progression of movements from the completion of the old turn through the transition or neutral and rolling the skis onto the new turning edges. the body inclinates or falls downhill in the direction of the new turn, rolling the skis onto the new turning edges. Tipped and pressured skis bend in a reverse camber and help carve and shape turns. Fore and aft movements in the ankles, knees, hips, spine, and arms maintain balance over the sweet spot for optimal ski performance. Good skiing starts with a solid athletic stance. Here, the athlete is always looking ahead. The shoulders remain relatively level with the hill. The back is slightly rounded with the weight forward. There's an open attitude of the arms, hands forward. The ankles, knees, and hips are flexed. The feet are naturally separated approximately hip width, and the skis are parallel. A balanced athletic stance should be maintained throughout all phases of a turn: the transition, initiation, and turning phase. The degree of flexion has to be constantly adjusted based on turn radius, terrain, and speed. Good athletic or skiing balance requires ankle, knee, and hip flexion. The amount of flexion will vary constantly depending upon the terrain and turn. A wide attitude of the hands and arms, with the hands and elbows ahead of the body, will help maintain a balanced position. Notice with this skier, the hands and arms are wide for balance, and the elbows and hands are carried well in advance of the body. Remember, you ski from the hips down, you balance from the waist up. The body should always be perpendicular or slightly ahead of perpendicular to the plane of the skis. Never let the body weight get behind the skis. This perpendicular position provides a stable platform that allows the feet to work independently and improves the skier's ability to efficiently adapt to changes in terrain. As we said earlier, the basic skiing stance is hip width, but will vary. It has to be functional and comfortable to allow for good balance. Foot separation can occur in both the horizontal and vertical planes. Separation in the vertical plane is usually the most dramatic. While skiing, separation is going to be dictated by the phase of the turn shape, and the terrain. Vertical separation is the distance the legs are separated vertically from a natural standing stance. If you stand on a set of steps sideways with one foot on the tread above the other, the vertical separation of your feet is the distance in height one foot to the other. This is constantly changing in skiing and is directly related to the edge angles that are developed. It's usually the greatest at or just after the apex of a turn when resisting the combined forces of gravity and centrifugal force. It's at its least during the transition phase between turns. As vertical separation increases, the outside leg lengthens and the inside leg becomes more flexed. This is sometimes referred to as the long leg and the short leg, respectively. Horizontal separation is how far the feet are apart. It's the same as when you're walking, running, or standing on your skis on a flat hill. It's pretty constant with some minor adjustments. It widens a little from the transition phase of a turn toward the apex of the ensuing turn. Timing of edge change affects the amount of horizontal separation between turn transition and the apex of the coming turn. In an early edge change and high edge angle, the horizontal separation of the feet is going to be quite small. A horizontal stance that's too narrow will limit balance, foot independence, and use of the inside ski. Horizontal stance that's too wide will cause the inside foot to carry too much of the weight and limit your ability to inclinate. A horizontal stance that's too wide at slower speed may make it difficult at turn transition to move the center of mass from one side of the skis to the other. The best skiers use both skis to turn. Weighted ratio constantly changes and varies at different parts of a turn. Maintaining parallel skis allows the inside ski to work more efficiently and in harmony with the dominant outside ski. More efficient, clean, smooth, fast arcs are achievable when both skis are working together. Even when the skier weights one ski more than another to balance against the outside ski, both skis turn simultaneously. Keep them parallel so both skis will be contributing to the turning process. Even when the outside ski is dominant or the master, the inside ski will actively be contributing to the turning process. The weight distribution ratio in a turn will vary from approximately 60 to 70% on the outside ski with 30 to 40% on the inside ski. To maintain dynamic balance on skis, the skier must rely on good fore-aft as well as lateral balance. During a turn, angulation should be developed in the hips with slight angulation in the knees and a subsequent leveling of the shoulders to create good lateral balance. This creates parallel alignment, which will result in good lateral balance. Leveling your field of vision to see the world as it actually exists, not tilted, may help when establishing angulation. Fore-aft balance requires constant adjustment in the fore, centered, and aft pressure on your skis. Remember, you're trying to maintain a perpendicular position with regard to the plane of the skis at all times. Let's remember, a balanced stance is essential. It'll give you greater freedom of movement and options from which you're able to manipulate your skis and vary the pressure on your edges. The width of your stance is personal and will vary from turn to turn with different terrain. Weight distribution from the inside ski to the outside ski is always changing throughout the turn. However, the outside ski is always going to remain the master and the inside ski is an active assistant. In skiing, arm and pole movements enhance balance, timing, flow, and rhythm. A properly timed pole touch or tap may be crucial in good slalom skiing. It's a skill the racer must have in their quiver of skills. Put these elements to work for you and watch your ski racing performance improve.